This is Noise from the Cranium. My name is Doug, and this episode is going to be a little different. I recently had the opportunity to interview guitarist Paul Rudolph, who gives us a glimpse of the underground music scene in England in the 1970s. Rudolph, who had been playing in the Vancouver band Hydroelectric Streetcar, was invited to move to England in 1969 by an old schoolmate, Jamie Mandelkow, who was managing a band called the Deviants. This move put him right in the heart of the British underground, where the counterculture was bubbling up from Ladbroke Grove. Rudolph spent 10 years in England, first playing with the Deviants before moving on to the Pink Fairies and Hawkwind, rubbing elbows with the likes of Mick Farren, Twink, Robert Calvert, and Brian Eno. It didn't take long for Rudolph to meet his first girlfriend, Sonia Christina, the eventual singer for prog band Curved Air.
The second night I was in London, you know, staying with the Deviants on top of the Shaftesbury Theater, below in the theater was Hair. And so the second night I was there, this beautiful woman showed up, you know, dressed like a hippie, and I, you know, kind of chatted with her, and they said, oh, this is Sonia, she's in Hair. You know, and we still stay in touch. She was my first girlfriend.
That's not Sonia Christina, was it? Oh, wow.
At the time, the Deviants were a raw, punky band with not much musicality. Basically a vehicle for Mick Farren's subversive and revolutionary literary and social aspirations, they insulted the audience and caused mayhem whenever possible. The addition of Rudolph, with his superior guitar playing, brought them up several notches musically. Playing festivals and shows with other well-known or soon-to-be well-known acts like Soft Machine, The Moody Blues, and Deep Purple was an eye-opener for Rudolph.
I mean, at that time, I'd never heard of the Deviants. And, you know, I thought, oh, they're just some small band, right? So the first gig with the Deviants, a week later, we're doing an open-air festival in Birmingham. Who's the backup band for us? Black Sabbath.
They recorded their third album in April 1969, but by this time, Farren could see the writing on the wall. Rudolph's improved musicality was embraced by the other guys in the band, with the exception of Farren, who felt it was not the direction that the band should go in. In a nutshell, Farren was politically motivated. Rudolph, a blazing psychedelic guitarist, was into the musicality of it. Meanwhile, the Deviants had cultivated a number of interesting musical connections during their existence, including Steve Peregrine Took from Tyrannosaurus Rex, and a drummer named Twink, who had stints in psychedelic band Tomorrow with Steve Howe and the Pretty Things. Mick Farren got Twink a record deal, and they recorded the album Think Pink in the summer of 1969, with a host of psychedelic musicians, including Took and fellow Deviant Rudolph.
Which is actually a lot of fun.
Rudolph was instrumental in co-writing most of the album, but due to his affable nature, he simply settled for session fees rather than making a fuss about songwriting credits. This would plague him on future recordings with Robert Calvert as well.
I wrote most of the music and co-wrote most of the songs on those albums, but I guess because of my personality, I never wanted to stick my foot out and go, I helped you write that song, you're giving me 50% of those publishing royalties. They basically paid me session fees, mm-hmm. And I was just so happy to play, and it was fun, you know. that I never thought about that. I mean, that Twink stuff, none of that would have happened. Twink and I used to share a place together. And we wrote all that stuff together because he couldn't play a note.
The punky attitude of the Deviants was maintained when Farren, Twink, and Took were in public. A few months earlier, while attending King Crimson's first live performance at the Speakeasy in London, they put on a shameful display that to this day, Paul wishes he could apologize to Robert Fripp for.
And before I die, I want to apologize to him because even though I wasn't part of the action, I was there at the Speakeasy at King Crimson's first gig, their debut gig. Right? Mick Farren, Twink, and a few other people poo-pooed people who were starting to be successful for some reason, right? So King Crimson's on the stage, Fripp's on his stool, they start to play, and suddenly Twink runs from behind the curtains at the back of the stage in the nude. So he starts to run out of the club while he gets grabbed and ejected. Steve Took's girlfriend, who'd taken far too many mandrakes, then staggers up to Fripp on the stool and starts licking his face, wrapping her arms around him, right? Well, she gets thrown out. Then Mick and some other people go to the top of the stairs that go down to the Speakeasy, which is a well-known club, and they throw garbage cans down the stairs. And I thought, that's a bloody stupid thing to do, you know? I'm trying to, you know, hanging around with these guys is making me look bad, right? Huh. And ever since then, I've always had this regret about, you know, that tainting, you know, King Crimson's first gig. But there was part of their anarchy thing. I mean, some of the people in the Deviants were leery of me because I wanted to play something that was actually memorable and musical, you know, not something that sounded like a metal saw on a pipe.
Rudolph arranged for the Deviants to fly to Vancouver to play a few gigs in the fall of 1969. Unfortunately, the gigs were a disaster, culminating in Mick Farren getting fired from the band.
Mick Farren kind of fell apart right in your hometown.
Mm-hmm.
It was like that was kind of just like a weird serendipity or something like...
It was totally weird. The afternoon before the gig, one of my old beatnik friends, who was a kind of an icon of the music scene in Vancouver, dropped by. And we were cooking this big chili up. And he said, I got just the spice you need for the chili. So he reached into his pocket, pulled out an ounce of fresh hash, crumbled it into the chili. Well, needless to say, 2 hours later, nobody could drive. And Mick totally freaked out.
Oh, boy.
The gig was kind of a disaster because everybody was like, you know, out of their element.
Trying to pick up the pieces, the Deviants had an interesting dilemma.
We thought we had return tickets. Well, we didn't. And he didn't have any money to pay us. And we had like 200, maybe 200 bucks, right? So we thought, what are we going to do? And somebody said, let's make a big bag of sandwiches and put the drums on a Greyhound and go to San Francisco. I talked to my beatnik friend, Ted, and he said, let me make a call. And so he called his friend, Chet Helms, and Chet said, here's my phone number. So we get to Frisco, phone up Chet Helms, where he got us billeted out. And, you know, we spent a couple of months there farting around.
Did you play any gigs?
Yeah, we played at the Fillmore.
Oh, you did?
Yeah, played at the Fillmore as the Deviants, but, you know, because we hadn't really started the Pink Fairy thing yet. And we played an absolutely eye-opening gig in Oakland. I never realized how big football was in the States. We played a football rally, right? So here's the Deviants on this stage in this huge amphitheater. And in the middle is a big bunch of wood. And at the finale of the band's last number, the mascot from the opposing football team, I think it was the Bears and somebody else. Anyway, the opposing team's mascot, which was just a dummy, came down a fly line into this pile of wood that they set on fire. And they're going, holy shit, we're country boys here. And we actually got paid. And, you know, that was one of our few San Francisco gigs.
They finally found a way to get out of Frisco.
Ultimately, we got rescued by Seymour Stein, who managed to get us airfares to Montreal. where we did a bunch of college gigs to get enough money to fly back to the UK. You know, we spent all winter in Montreal.
They thought of an interesting way to rustle up the cash to get back to England.
But how are we going to get enough money for all these airfares? So we had enough cash from one gig and we sent it to the drummer's girlfriend in London to buy a pound of hash. Right? We thought, okay, what do we do? How are we going to do? Great, we'll get the hash wrapped up, you know, in plastic and put it in a big bundle of underground newspapers, and we sent it, got it sent to the underground newspaper in Montreal. There was only one at the time. Well, the hash got sent, but the office said they never received it.
Back in England, what was left of the Deviants and Twink got together and formed a band.
Think about the idea of a band called the Pink Fairies, and, you know, there can be two drummers, and I'll play guitar, and Sandy will play bass. And so when we got back to London, that was the plan.
Twink suggested the name Pink Fairies, which was taken from a short story written by Mandelkow.
And admittedly, he was always fascinated with the English concept of fairies at the bottom of the garden. So we thought, that's cool.
They did quite well right from the outset.
And our first gig at the Roundhouse, it was amazing. First gig at the Roundhouse, not having any repertoire whatsoever. We got on stage at the Roundhouse, and there was 3,000 or 4,000 people in there as usual, and we actually got a standing ovation before even playing. Just because, I don't know, there was just something in the wind. I don't know how to put it, right? We were not superstars. We were just normal, you know, I'd describe us as kind of normal people, really.
As an underground band, they had to come up with unique ways of getting their music to the fans.
And the Deviants had started playing for free with a generator under this motorway flyover in Ladbroke Grove, where we all lived, doing these pirate concerts that were constantly getting shut down by the police. Finally, the city council said, no, this is great. So they put in a little stage and a power outlet.
They would use the flatbed truck at major festivals like the Bath Festival of Blues and Progressive Music and the Isle of Wight. Not on the bill, they would play for free with like-minded bands like Hawkwind after the main show was done for the evening. Occasionally, both bands would jam, calling themselves Pink Wind. The Pink Fairies released their first album, Never Neverland, in May 1971. Twink left after the first album, and Rudolph had had enough after the second, largely due to drummer Russell Hunter's rampant drug use.
I left the Pink Fairies because the drummer had fallen prey to the heroin thing, right? And his playing started to go downhill. I mean, we were sort of a second-tier band. We were never, like, top-tier, but second-tier. But we were fairly popular amongst the young crowd. But I was so worried about younger people thinking that this was cool behavior.
I'd like to thank Paul Rudolph for sharing his interesting stories and for being a gracious host and an all-around nice guy. And to Rob Frith from Neptune Records for inviting me along to the Q&A. Join me for part two of my Paul Rudolph interview, where we discuss Brian Eno replacing Lemmy in Hawkwind and the nasty business of the music industry. I'm going to leave you with the title track from the first Pink Fairies album, Never Neverland. This has been Noise from the Cranium. Thanks for listening, and I'll catch you next time.